Hey, Professor.
I hear breathing, Gabe. Gabe?
Hey, Professor, just in case you're talking, I can't hear you at all.
You can't hear me at all.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Damn. At all now, Gabe?
All right, I can hear you.
All right, sorry.
No, you're fine.
Did we get through all the intermolecular forces?
I think so. I can't remember if we got through all of them or not.
Hydrogen bonding. Do you know what I'm talking about with that?
Yes, it
Okay.
was.
If
I
I got through
think so.
hydrogen bonding, then I got through it. Because ion dipole are not that big a deal, okay?
Right.
Enough, Gabe? All right.
Yep.
Just as a summary of everything, dispersion involved temporary population of the electrons on one side of the element, on one side of the atom or the other. If the electrons are on one side, say they're on this side, that makes this side of the molecule negative, the other side positive. And it attracts the next one that same way. And it goes on further and further. These are temporary charges. They are the weakest. All right. Again, with dispersion, larger the molecule, larger the electron cloud. If you have a larger electron cloud, you have greater force. If you have greater force, it takes more energy to get something to boil. So if I'm dealing with something like, oh, we'll talk about nitrogen, which has a molecular weight of 28, versus something like hydrogen disulfide, which has a, let's back off on that, okay, Gabe? I have nitrogen as a molecular weight of 28, and I have something like krypton, which has a molecular weight of 83. Because the krypton weighs more, there's more electron clouds there. Krypton is going to have a larger boiling point than nitrogen is. Seem fair enough?
Yeah, for the most part.
All right. The other thing we need to take into account is branching.
So, sorry, one second. Let me just make sure I got that. The more they weigh, the bond order is greater.
Now, you can't think of it as bond order because it's not really bonding. It's just the attraction for one molecule for the other.
Okay.
All right.
All
So the
right.
bigger they are, the stronger the force. The stronger the force, the more temperature it's going to take to cause them to boil or
Okay.
freeze. Okay?
All right.
Or to, I'm sorry, to not freeze, to melt. All right? Okay, now the other thing is branching. If we have two molecules that are branched, I can't pack them as close to one another. Since I can't pack them as close to one another, the atoms are further apart. If the atoms are further apart or the molecules are further apart, this means that those forces are weaker. If the forces are weaker, this means that it takes less temperature. So branched molecules boil at a lower temperature than molecules that are not branched. Again, makes sense?
Yeah, it makes sense.
All right, dipole-dipole are polar molecules. These are a permanent charge within the molecule. Because it's a permanent charge within the molecule, those forces are stronger than dispersion. So it takes more energy to boil those than it does to those molecules only with dispersion. Then we have hydrogen bonding. This is a special dipole-dipole. in which we have a portion of the molecule has hydrogen in it, and the other portion has either three elements, nitrogen, oxygen, or fluorine. If it consists of this, that creates a very, very strong dipole-dipole, stronger than most normal dipole-dipoles. So hydrogen bonding is even stronger than dipole-dipole. So therefore, it's going to take even more energy to boil those. Okay, ion dipole, the last one. In ion dipole, what we have there is we have something that not only has a permanent charge, it gets to take all of that charge because it's stolen the electrons or it's given up its electrons. Since not only is it permanent, but it is all of the charge, those are stronger than dipole-dipole. Make sense, Gabe?
Yeah.
So basically, you're going to have to look at molecules. You're going to have to determine whether or not they are going to exhibit which type of these intermolecular forces. And based upon that, you're going to have to come up with what's going to boil at a higher or lower temperature. Work through it just the same way I just worked through it. Okay, Gabe? If the force is stronger, it's going to take more energy, higher temperature. Okay?
All right.
All right, we got to get into three more basic things. One is the vaporization of these particular substances. Okay? So we have to deal with vaporization, which is going to involve a formula called the Clausius-Clapeyron. Then we're going to delve back into thermodynamics, and we're going to see how much energy it's going to take a substance at a solid below the freezing point all the way through that same substance when it is in a vapor form. And the last thing I'm hoping to get to is phase diagrams today. All right. So when we're boiling something, Gabe, what's going to affect the rate of evaporation?
The heat.
The amount of energy you put into it, yeah. But if you put the same amount of energy into two different solutions, made of two different compounds, what's keeping something as a liquid?
The composition or the...
What forces are keeping it a liquid?
Oh, intermolecular forces.
So if I have a stronger intermolecular force, this means it's going to take more energy to get that to evaporate. Okay. There are some other factors that are involved. You came up with one of them, the temperature. Higher the temperature, you're going to get more of the molecules that are able to have the energy to evaporate. And the last thing is the surface area. If you have a substance, if you have an opening that's the size of my watch face, okay, That's going to take more energy than something that is the size of my coffee cup. Does that make sense here?
Yes.
Okay, because the reason for that is you have more of the molecules closer to the surface with the right amount of temperature. And what happens if we do a statistical analysis? If we have a low temperature, we have a certain energy at which is the escape velocity, if we can call it that. Escape velocity meaning the liquid going into a vapor. As we raise the temperature, what happens is that we flatten the curve out, and the effect of flattening the curve out has is that we get many more molecules with the energy needed to escape. So, by definition, the amount of energy needed to vaporize one mole of a liquid to a gas is called the heat of vaporization. And basically what this is this is the energy needed to overcome the intermolecular forces of that liquid. So, Heat of vaporization of ethanol is 38.6 kilojoules per mole. How much energy does it take to completely turn 55.6 grams of ethanol from a liquid into a gas? All this is a dimensional analysis problem, Gabe. How are we going to solve it?
Okay, so you do 55.6 grams times or multiply by 1 divided by C2H6O. Let me get my periodic table out.
Don't worry. I'll give you that information in a second. It turns out to be 46.
Right, so okay. 55.6 divided by 46. And then, then you multiply by 38.6.
That's exactly what we're going to do. Ian, I just have to address it. Yeah, Ian, all we've done so far is I have reviewed the intermolecular forces. And okay. I'm going on to heat of vaporization and the energy needed to evaporate something. There are three forces. Right. There are three things we need to consider when we're evaporating something: the energy input to that system, the intermolecular forces, and the surface area. The greater the surface area, less energy needed. The more energy you put in, more the stuff goes into the gas. Stronger the intermolecular forces, the more energy you're going to need to evolve it. So you've basically gotten caught up with everything we're doing. All right, Ian?
All righty.
All right. I just have a problem here. I've got the heat of vaporization is 38.6 kilojoules per mole. I'm asking how much energy does it take to completely turn that amount of grams of ethanol from a liquid into a gas? And Gabe just came up with the solution, dimensional analysis formula problem. I'm going to change the grams in the moles. Then I'm simply going to just take the moles of ethanol and multiply it by the heat of vaporization. I do that out. The molar mass of ethanol is 46.07. That gives me 1.21 moles of ethanol. I simply multiply that by the heat of vaporization. And that gives me a greater energy. And it makes sense because I have more than one mole of the stuff. So therefore, I'm going to need more energy. Make sense, guys?
Yeah, it makes sense.
All right. If I apply 26 kilojoules of energy to 43.7 grams of ice, would I have any ice left? Ian, can you see how I'm going to do this?
Yes.
That's not what I wanted to do. Crap. Okay, let's go, Ian. How are we going to do this?
First would be to find out the molar mass of ice, and then determine
what is the molar mass of ice. Ian, come on! What is the molar mass of ice?
Isn't it 8?
No, not 8.
I don't
point
have
something.
The periodic table in front of
me. Oh, come on, Ian! What's the atomic weight of hydrogen?
1.07, I think.
1.008. And oxygen?
Okay. And sorry, I don't have a periodic table, but then
come on, Ian.
Is that 6 or 8?
No.
Oxygen would be 8. So would it be 9?
No. Oxygen weighs 16.
Oh Jesus, I was way off. Okay, so that'd be 17.
18. H2O. H2O.
So then it would be 18.
Okay, so what are you gonna do with
my bad. So you're going to multiply the 18 molar mass times 1 mole over 43.7.
Are you?
Grams, and you're going to get the amount of...
Are you going to do that? Remember, a molar mass is grams per mole. Are you going to divide the 18 by the 43?
No.
What are you going to do, Ian?
Wait. Yeah. Wait, I don't know why I'm so lost. Would you multiply it by the 43.7?
Nope, you have 43.7 grams. Remember, molar weight is grams per mole. If you want moles and you have grams, how do you get moles?
Divide by grams.
Divide by the molecular weight. So you're going to take the 43.7 and multiply it by one mole over 18.02 grams. So I get 2.43 moles of ice. What am I going to do now?
Okay. One sec. I did that backwards. Then you're going to take your 2.43 moles and then multiply it by the 26 kilojoules.
Multiply it?
Oh, wait. I'll be honest. I don't really know what to do.
Okay. Fair enough. We're going to compare it to this, aren't we, Ian?
Yes.
So if my total energy is 26 kilojoules and I know I have 2.43 moles of ice, how do I get the labels to look equal?
You'd have to get it to kilojoules.
I have kilojoules right here.
Oh. So divided by the moles.
Divided by the moles.
26 by 2.43.
So if I have 2.43 moles of ice, this means I have to sit here and think. I did it a different way. Okay. But I think I also, I could do it that way. That way will work, Ian.
Which way?
The way you're suggesting.
Oh.
All right. I have, crap. That's not what I want. And show, I want to go here. And I want new slide. So we divided 26 kilojoules by the 2.43. Okay. And this gives me 10.6. This is what I have. Do I have enough heat of fusion? Ian?
Oh, my bad. It was on mute. Yes, you do.
No. This is what I need.
Oh, and you have 6.0.
This is what I have.
Okay.
Do I have enough?
That. No, you don't.
Okay. All right, another way to do this problem, and one that probably makes a little more sense. This is how many moles of ice that I have, correct?
Correct.
All right, if I multiply, this is the energy I have. If I multiply that by one mole over the 6.02 kilojoules, this means if I have this much energy, I can melt that much ice.
Okay.
Does that make sense to you, Ian?
Yes.
This is all I have. Do I have enough energy to melt that much ice?
No.
Okay, Ian, this is the amount that I have. This is the amount that I can. This is the amount I have. This is the amount that energy will melt. Do I have enough energy to melt the 2.43 moles of ice?
Oh, yes.
Okay, so the answer is yes. And we're gonna eliminate this because that solution was not correct. Okay? This is what happens when I ad lib. This is the way you solve the problem. Okay?
Got it.
The other way you can solve this problem is you could take the 6.02 kilojoules per mole times the 2.43 moles. This means to melt this ice, I would need that much energy. Okay, Ian, are you with me?
Yes, I just keep pressing mute. I apologize.
No problem. If this is my heat of vaporization and this is right. The amount of moles I have, I would need this much energy to melt all that. Correct, Ian?
Correct.
So I have 26. Do I have enough energy to melt all that much ice?
Yes.
Okay. Again, going back, I can also do this by taking my energy and my heat of fusion and determine how many it could melt. I have less than that amount, so therefore I have enough energy. Does that make sense to you, Ian?
Yes.
All right. We have NH3. What type of intermolecular forces are involved? NH3. Guys, you got to recognize these. All right. Is there an electronegative difference between nitrogen and hydrogen?
Yes.
Yes, there is. Absolutely. So if there is an electronegative, you have at least dipole, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Simple solution. Where is SB on the electronegativity chart? Is it below nitrogen?
Yes.
So is the force, if this was just a dipole, is the force for between antimony and H stronger or weaker than the force between nitrogen and hydrogen? Remember, the electronegativity difference is greater for nitrogen. So which is going to have the greater force?
Nitrogen.
Nitrogen. So if it has the greater force, you are going to need to have more energy to boil it. All right. The other thing is, remember, nitrogen with a hydrogen is hydrogen bonding. This antimony with hydrogen is only dipole. So even looking at this, this has hydrogen bonds. This only has dipole. So I'm going to have stronger intermolecular forces for ammonia than for antimony trihydride. Again, does it make sense? And this continues on. If I'm going to look at these structures, you have to be able to see these structures and be able to discern what type of intermolecular forces are there. Okay. Right now, you don't have a good sense of organic structure. So acetone is, I'm going to get out of here and get in the whiteboard for a second. Okay, structure-wise, water. You got to look at these and be able to discern what the intermolecular forces are. What's the strongest intermolecular force for that? Come on, guys. What makes up hydrogen bonding? Gabe, Ian, somebody.
Are you talking about like the SP?
No, I'm not talking about SP. I'm talking about intermolecular forces. Remember, we have four.
Right.
Dispersion are less than dipole-dipole, which are less than hydrogen bonding, which are less than ion dipole. Okay. Now you got to look at this. What does that have? What type of intermolecular force does that have?
Hydrogen bonding.
Hydrogen bonding. What about this one?
Same thing.
Okay, but does this one have a portion of the molecule that is not involved with hydrogen bonding?
Yes.
So the more of this stuff you have, it kind of detracts from the hydrogen bonding. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because not only do you have hydrogen bonding, but you have a portion of the molecule that is got dispersion on it. Does that make sense to you? Oops. Does that make sense, guys?
Yeah.
All right. So I then have acetone here. What type of forces are involved with this? CHs are only dispersion. If you see a C with an H, the electronegativity isn't strong enough. It's just a non-polar bond. Do I have any polar bonds in here?
The O and the C?
The O and the C. I've got a dipole here. So I have a dipole-dipole. Hydrogen bonding with extra stuff out there that is going to detract from the hydrogen bonding. I've got dipole-dipole, and I have a last one, which is ether, which is this molecule. Now, if I'm dealing with this monster, does this have any polarity to it? Is it a symmetrical molecule? Is it symmetrical, guys?
Yes.
If it's symmetrical, no polarity. No polarity, no dipole-dipole. What's the only force involving this?
Would it be hydrogen? Oh, wait, no. Dispersion?
Dispersion's the only one that's involved with this one. No dipole-dipoles. So, dispersion is the weakest. Hydrogen bonding in this scenario is the strongest. So, what would you expect from highest boiling point being 1, lowest 4? Rate them for me.
OH would have the most.
We're going to go 1.
Yeah, and then 2 would be.
Which one between these is going to be 3, and which one's going to be 4?
3's on the left and 4's on the right.
Gabe, are you seeing this? Gabe, you understanding?
Yes. I mean, I'm trying to, kind of.
All right, you got to look at the molecules.
Right.
This one only has hydrogen bonding involved in it, right?
Mm-hmm.
This one has hydrogen bonding, but it's got this other stuff that is nonpolar attached to it that's going to detract from the hydrogen bonding. So this one, for that reason, is going to be weaker than this one.
Okay.
But it still has hydrogen bonding in it. This one only has a dipole-dipole. So dipole-dipole are less strong than hydrogen bonding. And this one, because it's a not a polar molecule, only has dispersion, so it's going to be the weakest. Does that make sense to you, Gabe?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to show one more thing before I get out of here. I've got two molecules. I have methanol. And I have ethanol. Now we're going to go out a couple ways. We're going to go to butanol. I'm getting better at this, aren't I, guys? Lie for me.
You're doing great.
Yeah. Okay, this is butanol. What's the main difference between methanol and butanol? What's the main difference?
The amount of dispersion forces?
Yeah. You got all these. You got four of these carbon hydrogen things out here. Over here, you only have one. So which one do you think is going to have the larger percentage of, just for reference sakes, of hydrogen bonding?
The one on the left?
So which one do you think is going to boil? What's that?
Wouldn't they have the same amount of hydrogen bonding?
But this one is kind of diluted because I have a whole lot of non-polar stuff here, right?
Right, okay.
So which one is going to boil at a higher temperature?
The right.
This one has dispersion. Dispersion's weaker than hydrogen bonding.
Oh, so left.
That one's going to boil at a higher temperature. Does that make sense to you guys? The more nonpolar character you have in a molecule, by nonpolar character, what you should translate that into being is the more carbon hydrogen bonds. More carbon hydrogen bonds you have, that means the more nonpolar character you have, which means it is going to boil at a lower temperature because the dispersion factors are going to interfere. And so we're going to go back to share screen. All right, now, if I just leave this flask with the cork off, if I put rubbing alcohol, you take the cap off of the rubbing alcohol. After a while, what happens to all the rubbing alcohol?
It gets diluted by air.
No, it doesn't get diluted by air. If you look at the volume of the rubbing alcohol, what happens to the volume over time?
Evaporates.
It evaporates away, the volume goes down, right? Now, correct. If I put the cap on, what happens is, immediately after my putting that cap on, I have molecules of isopropanol that are evaporating to fill the airspace above the liquid. And enough of the isopropanol goes up here so that I have what's known as a dynamic equilibrium. It's not that nothing is happening. The concentration of the isopropanol in the air and the concentration of the isopropanol in the liquid isn't changing. But what is changing is when I get to that magical equilibrium point, the rate of my isopropanol that is condensing is equal to the rate of my isopropanol that is evaporating. So when I put a cork on something, that means I have this constant changing, but the rate going up is equal to the rate going down. So we have a rate of evaporation that's pretty much constant. But at first, I don't have any isopropanol in the atmosphere above. So that rate's going to be low. But as I put more and more of the isopropanol in the air, my rate of condensation keeps on increasing until it equals the rate of my evaporation. The pressure, when it reaches dynamic equilibrium, is called the vapor pressure. Now, what happens is the system reacts. The system will react to get back to that same equilibrium it had before. It wants condensation rate to be equal to evaporation rate. So if I've got a cylinder here and I jack the cylinder up so I have more volume, this means my concentration in the air is not as strong as it was when it was, the volume was less. So what's going to happen is my rate of evaporation is going to increase until it reaches the point where the condensation concentration gets enough where the rate of condensation is the same as evaporation. By the same token, if I take that cylinder and jam it back down, what happens is I've now made my isopropanol in the air above the liquid too concentrated. So I want to fix that. And the way to fix this is to make my condensation rate increase over my evaporation rate. And that continues on until the rates become equal again. Does that make sense, guys? You're going to get into equilibriums heavily in next semester. This is just your first exposure to what an equilibrium is. Vapor pressure is going to depend upon temperature and IM forces. Why? Why is that going to happen?
Wouldn't it determine what state the substance would be in?
Mm-hmm. If you have stronger IM forces, you're going to need more temperature to get them up into the atmosphere. So the IM forces are going to be dependent upon, or the vapor pressure is going to be dependent upon how much force you have holding these two things to be a liquid. More energy you put in, more of the stuff you're going to get evaporated. Higher your vapor pressure. If you put more energy in, if you increase the temperature, vapor pressure also goes up. If you increase the force holding these things together, you're going to have less vapor in the air. For example, look at diethyl ether. Diethyl ether, we said, was nonpolar, only has dispersion, weak IM forces. I put the same temperature in, there's more diethyl ether in the air than there is ethyl alcohol. If I look at ethyl alcohol versus water, same thing. Same temperature, there is less water in the air than there is ethyl alcohol. By the same token, if I have it at the same vapor pressure, I need to input more energy to get the ethanol in to the same pressure as the diethyl ether. I need 40 degrees for the ethyl alcohol to develop a 200 torr vapor pressure, whereas for ether, that'll occur at zero. So I can relate. Basically, what I'm doing here is I am relating vapor pressure with temperature. By the way, whenever you see a curved line like this, assume it's going to involve a log. So I develop an equation called the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. And this is a nonlinear relationship between vapor pressure and temperature. What? Forget this line. This is definitely a, I'm sorry, I just got lost there for a second. Remember I said, whenever you have a curved line, assume there's going to be a log involved. Remember I just said that?
Yeah.
All right. Clausius-Clapeyron is a nonlinear relationship. I'm relating pressure directly with temperature. It's nonlinear, isn't it? Guys? Nonlinear?
Right.
Yeah.
All right. Now, I want to make it linear. The way I make it linear is I take the log of one portion of it. If I take the log of one portion of it, I can make this into a linear relationship. If I take the log, natural log of the pressure of the vapor, I can make that equal to negative the heat of vaporization divided by R times 1 over T plus the ln of B. Now, what does this look like, the equation of? If I told you that I'm plotting the ln of P on the y-axis, and I am plotting 1 over T on the x-axis, does that help you? Yeah. Y is equal to mx plus b. What's that the equation of?
Slope.
A line, yes.
Right.
So this, what scientists like to do is they like to change equations so that they can graph them and get a straight line. Now, I can't directly measure the heat of vaporization, can I? But no. Can I measure temperature?
Yeah.
Can I measure pressure?
Yes.
So if I measure the pressure and I measure the temperature, I can substitute them into this and use a graph where I know the slope. The slope of plotting the ln of P versus 1 over T is going to be negative heat of vaporization over R. So my M, my slope, is equal to minus heat of vaporization divided by R. Guys, get used to this. If you're going on to Chem 2, they do this all the time. They do this all the time in Chem 2. They take two values, make one into a log, that makes the equation a straight line. Then they're able to find a value by making it into the slope. So if I'm looking at this equation, beta is a constant that's going to depend upon the gas. T is the temperature at which the stuff is. Delta heat of vaporization is the heat of vaporization. Now, we have a new constant. We have a new constant. Look at the label. Is the label liter atmospheres per degree Kelvin mole? Is it? So if it's not that, if I'm putting joules over mole K, This means my number is going to change. So R can have a different value. When we're dealing with this, R is going to have a value of joules per mole. So there's a couple things you have to remember about this. R is in joules per mole. Remember this. R is in joules per mole. Heat of vaporization is going to be in kilojoules per mole. So again, I have, if I plot my Y as my ln of P vaporization and my X is 1 over T, I will get a straight line. The straight line will have a slope. That slope is equal to minus delta H vaporization over R. So I've done that here. When you're doing these graphs, you will get a line that has a negative slope all the time. So I have figured out my equation for my line is negative 4288 X plus 18.806. Riddle me this, Batman. If I know my slope is equal to negative 4288, how do I get my heat of vaporization?
What's plug a value in for X?
Well, what's the slope equal to? What's the number value of the slope?
The pressure?
Nope. What's the number? I've got my equation of a line here, guys. What's my number value for my slope?
4288.1.
All right. It's 42, negative 4288.
Right.
Remember, Y is equal to MX plus B. What is my slope equal to? 42, negative 4288. So to determine my heat of vaporization, R is a constant, 8.314 joules per mole K. If I multiply negative R by my slope, I will get my heat of vaporization. I have my slope, multiply it by negative R. This gives me 35,650 joules per mole. Normally speaking, I want to change this into kilojoules. So this would be 35.6 kilojoules per mole. Are you understanding? Are you understanding what we're doing here?
Yes.
You've got a graph. If you have a graph of LNP versus 1 over T, find out what the equation of the line is. Once you find the equation of the line, you know that the slope, the number of the slope, is equal to negative delta H vape over R. So you're going to take your slope, multiply it by negative R. That's going to be your heat of vaporization. Questions?
Okay. The X will always be in the formula, right?
What's that?
X will be in the formula, correct?
What do you mean by that?
Go back to the graph where it's 428.1X.
Yes.
So in your formula above, the X isn't a multiplication. It's an actual X. LNP VAP equals negative delta T over R. Is that okay. Times or is that an X?
Ian, what's the value of L? See what I'm circling? What's the value of Y? What am I circling?
LNP.
Okay.
LNP.
Yeah. What's my X? One over T, right?
Right.
So.
Oh, okay, I get it now.
All right. Now, I've just, with this equation, I'm just employing one T and one P value. If I have the circumstances under which I have two values of T and two values of P, I can combine those two equations by subtracting one from the other. When I do that, I come up with the 2.4. Okay? This is the same equation you used in your lab. Actually, both of them were. Remember you did the graph?
Yeah.
In the lab? And remember you found the slope? And you multiplied the slope by R to come up with your heat of vaporization? Do you remember that?
Yeah, I did it backwards, though, on the lab.
I'm not going to go into that. This is the first part of the lab. Okay? This is where you had a boiling point. So you have one temperature. The thing you have to understand is at the boiling point, the pressure is equal to atmospheric pressure. And if we're dealing in most circumstances, pressure at boiling is going to be atmospheric, which is 760. So if I know what my boiling point is, I can put that into P1 and T1. I can then solve for a fourth value if I know either the temperature that I'm going to want to find the pressure at, or I know the pressure, I'm going to want to know what the temperature is. Okay. Now, I want to say this point right now, because you are going to see this equation. You're going to see this equation in different forms. You're going to see ln P1 over P2 is equal to negative delta heat vape over R times 1 over P1 minus 1 over P2. You will see it like that. You will see it like ln P1 over P2 is equal to a positive delta heat vape over R times 1 over T2 minus 1 over T1. Mathematically, you can change one into the other by doing that. What I want you to know from my conversation right now, pick one formula, memorize it, write it down on your notes for the test, and don't vary from it, okay? If you're using whatever goes on top of the log, goes in the first T form. Whatever is in the back of the log goes into the second T form. That's the first error I see for Clausius Clapeyron. Second error, heat of vaporization is kilojoules, R is in joules. You have to convert one to the other. That is the second error. And the third one I'm going to get into in a little bit later. So if I have this equation, again, that's what this slide is about. You can refer, all three of these are equal and they can be used to solve. I don't care which one you use. I don't care which one you use. Just pick one and stick with it. All right, as a general question, as the temperature goes up, is T2 bigger than T1 as the temperature goes up?
No, yes.
All right. So, Ian, if T2 is greater than T1, what is the sign of this particular portion of this equation?
Positive.
It's positive.
Positive.
No, is it positive? T2 is bigger than T1.
But wouldn't that be like 200 minus 100?
No, it's 1 over 200 minus 1 over 100. Let's go simpler numbers. It would be 1/2 minus, if the temperature is increasing, I have 1/2 minus, no, let's do it this way. If my temperature is going up, right, Ian?
Right.
Then
right.
T2 is bigger than T1. I have a right. 3/3, and T2 is 3, T1 is 2.
Okay.
So I have 1/3 minus 1/2, or 0.33 minus 0.50. What's the sign?
Negative.
Negative. If T2 is going up, then this sign is going to be negative. Right, Ian?
Correct.
Gabe, did you see that?
Yeah.
All right, so if this term is negative, I'm multiplying it by a negative. What is the whole left side of this equation?
Negative.
I've got a negative times a negative, Gabe.
It would be positive. It would be positive.
All right, so the right side of this equation is a positive. Do you know anything about logs? When is a log positive?
Always.
No. A log is positive when it is greater than 1. Okay? If a log is equal to a positive number, then it is greater than 1. How do I get the log to be greater than 1? What's the relationship between P2 and P1?
1 P2 be greater than P1?
P2 would have to be greater than P1. And it makes sense. Remember we said, as we increase the temperature, doesn't the pressure go up?
Yeah.
So that is how you analyze equations when you're doing Chem 2 problems. Again, T2 is bigger than T1. So the 1/T2 minus 1/T1 term is going to be negative. I multiply that times the negative in front of this. This makes the whole right side of the equation positive. In order for the log to be positive, I have to have a value greater than 1. Therefore, P2 is bigger than P1. Are you following the logic there?
Yes.
All right. Benzene has a heat of vaporization of 30.72. It has a boiling point of 80.1. At what temperature does benzene boil when the external pressure is 445? All right. If this is my overall question, this is my overall reaction. This is my overall equation, right? It may seem right. Like I haven't given you enough information. I've given you delta H, I've given you 1 pressure, I've given you 1 temperature, haven't I?
Mm-hmm.
All right. You have to realize under normal conditions, the boiling point is 80.1. What is the pressure at the boiling point?
1 atmosphere.
760 torr. Okay. So in fact, I have given you enough information to solve this problem. I have 1 pressure. I have another pressure. I have 1 temperature and I have the heat of vaporization. So therefore, I can solve this problem. So I'm going to plug it in. I've got my first value. Remember, the value here, the pressure here has to be the first temperature. So I have 1 ln of 445 divided by 760 is equal to the heat of vaporization divided by, remember I said, I have to turn one into the other, guys. I either have to turn the kilojoules into moles, or I have to turn the joules into kilojoules. In this instance, I decided to divide my 8.314 by 1,000 to come up with this number. That's equal to 1 over T2 minus 1 over 353.5. I do this math out. I get 0.586 is equal to, I divide this number by this one. I end up with 3,695 times 1 over T2 minus this number works out to be 0.00283. The ln of this is equal to a negative 5.34. This times this is 3,695 over T2 plus this number times this number gives me 10.5. Subtract 10.5 from both sides. I get this is equal to this number over that. I end up with my T2 being 234. Are we good with this solution, guys? Are we good?
Yeah.
Ian? Or is it Gabe? Who's saying,
I would say I'm good. Probably me.
Okay.
10 to the third, are you just using that so it's not a long number?
Yes.
Okay.
I can write this out as negative 3,695 times 0.00283.
Okay.
I multiply those two numbers together. I get, these are negative times a negative. I get a positive 10.5.
Got it.
Okay. Now, the one problem that I haven't shown. Understand, guys, that I have another set of problems for the Clausius Clapeyron. It's in another PowerPoint, but I really must get to something else before the class ends today. Okay?
All right.
If I know the temperatures, if I know the both temperatures, and I know one of the pressures, generally speaking, what will happen is it'll be a question like you were asked in the lab. If it boils at this temperature, what's the vapor pressure going to be at this other temperature? So you're given both temperatures and you're given one pressure. What you have to do is you have to numerically solve for what this value is going to be, because you're going to know the heat of vaporization, you're going to know R, and you're going to know both values of T. Solve for the numeric value of what this is. Then you're going to have the ln of a number over X. Or you're going to have the ln of X over a number. More than likely, 760 is going to be that number. What you can't do, if it's ln of X over 760, you can't multiply the right side by 760 and get rid of it. You can't do that. You have to get rid of the log first. So whatever this number is, you have to take E to that value. That gets rid of the log. Then once you take E to that value, you can multiply the E to whatever that value is by the 760. That will give you your other pressure. That's how you solve the math problems involving logs. All right. We're going to get into, I got 10 minutes yet to do this. Hopefully we'll have enough time. All right. When you're at the boiling point, you're increasing the temperature. You're increasing the temperature until you reach the point where there's enough energy to have all the molecules break away and enter the gas phase. If all the molecules have the necessary thermal energy to be released as vapor, you are at the boiling point. Basically, if you've ever watched water boil, I don't have a life so I can do this. If you ever watch it, you're going to see some very, very tiny bubbles at first. What you're doing is you're taking all the gas that's dissolved in the water and you're evaporating that first. Then if you watch water, you get these bubbles later on that form at the bottom and they come up and they burst before they get to the top. Those have not reached sufficient pressure. But then you're going to get those bubbles that go until they reach the top and then they explode into the air. You've reached the boiling point at that. The enthalpies in a phase change depend upon the amount of substance and what the substance is. That's how we get to boiling point. The heat of vaporization of water is different than the heat of vaporization of ethanol. So what we do, if we're doing a heating curve for water, what happens if we have ice? All the energy, if I'm putting heat on the ice, all that energy is going to raise that temperature of the ice until I get to the melting point. So I'm taking all that ice, it's raising the temperature until I get to 0 degrees centigrade. Then I'm adding more and more energy into there. As I'm adding more and more energy in, the temperature is not increasing because all the energy I'm putting into that system is going into breaking the intermolecular bonds. When I've broken all the intermolecular bonds, the energy, it then goes to raising the temperature again. So I've got water at this point, I'm going up, I'm increasing the water temperature until I get to the boiling point. Again, there are intermolecular forces which is keeping the water as a liquid. I am putting more and more energy in, but all of that energy is going into breaking those intermolecular bonds, making it a liquid. So the temperature is not increasing until I reach the point where I've broken all the intermolecular forces. At that point, the temperature can go up again. Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
All right. Now, you have used all of these formulas before. You've used them before. I know you have. When I've got a slanted line, I'm going to use the formula, the same formula you did in calorimetry. The heat I have to add is going to be equal to the mass of the liquid times the specific heat times the final temperature minus the initial temperature. Have you heard that before?
Yes.
All right. Now, when I get to a stage where I'm either at the freezing point or I'm at the condensation point, I have to break the intermolecular forces. So if I'm at the freezing point, I'm going to multiply my heat of fusion, which is in kilojoules per mole, by the number of moles of the substance I have. Have you done that equation before? Yes, we just did it earlier today. So if I'm on a slanted line of the curve, I'm using Q is equal to MS delta T. If I'm on the flat line, I am using the delta H. If I'm boiling it, that's the delta H of vaporization. If I'm melting it, it's the delta H of fusion. When I'm on a flat line, I'm taking one of those delta H's and multiplying it by the moles. Now, another thing you have to understand, because they're different substances, these specific heats are different. The specific heat of ice is different than the specific heat of water, which is different than the specific heat of steam. Delta H of fusion is different than the delta H of vaporization. So, my question is, where is my question? All right, let's look at the first stage. I'm starting at minus 25, okay? I'm going. I want to know how much energy it takes me to go from minus 25 to 125. So I'm going through heat of fusion. I'm going through heat of vaporization. First thing I have to do, it's a big journey, guys. I have to solve the problem. How do I get my ice from minus 25 to zero? I'm going to use my MC delta T. Okay, I need to know how much I have.
Hey, okay, professor.
And I need to see what I used. Okay, well, sorry. Let's just go with this, all right? So I'm gonna have to know how much ice I have, and I'm gonna multiply that by my specific heat of the ice times my final temperature is zero minus a negative 25. Are we clear on that?
Hey, Professor, I need to go for math class.
Okay, Gabe. Gabe, I'm I so want sorry, you to man. Look at the rest of this.
I will.
All right, sure. Ian, are you still here?
Yeah.
All right, can you continue on, Ian?
Yeah, I'm at work. I'm all good.
Okay. All right, Ian.
Uh-huh.
All right. So I have now determined the energy going from minus 25 to zero. We good with that?
Yeah.
All right. The next thing I have to do is I have to deal with this flat line. To go from solid to liquid, I have to use the heat of fusion. So I'm going to have to use a different equation. My heat to do this is equal to my number of moles times my delta heat of fusion. Okay. I've now gotten the energy to get my way from ice to water. Right. Now I need to find the energy it's going to take to go from zero to 100 degrees, because that's what it boils at. So I'm going to use the mass of my water times my specific heat of water times 100 minus zero. I have now gotten to this point on my curve.
Okay.
Now I'm going to use the same formula I did before, only instead of using the heat of fusion, I'm going to use the heat of vaporization. So to go from a liquid to a gas, I'm going to need to know the moles of my liquid times my heat of vaporization.
Okay.
So I've gotten it all the way this way. Now I'm going to use my last equation, which is my grams of water, or grams I started with, times my specific heat of steam, times my final temperature was 125 minus 100. So you're understanding what we're doing. Flat lines, we're using N delta H, whether it be fusion or vaporization. When so I'm on the go ahead.
Sorry. Will you give us like a like the picture and then ask for a specific stage?
No, okay. I won't give you the picture. You just you're just gonna have to do that in your mind. Graphically, Ian, for me to do that, it's a whole hell of a lot of work for the benefit.
So if you were to ask a question, would it involve all five stages or?
Let me ask you this question, Ian. How long do you think it's going to take me to take you to do all five of those stages?
Probably a good amount of time.
Will I have gained any more information from your knowledge if I just ask you from like taking it from water to steam or taking it from water to ice? Wouldn't that give me the same amount of information as to what whether you know what you're doing?
Yeah.
I will not ask you all five stages. I will definitely go from one substance, one state of matter to another state of matter. I will do that.
Though. Okay. Now, do the boiling points and what was the other one? Was it steam vapor pressure?
Boiling point? Are you talking about boiling and melting points?
Wait, go back to with the segment five that you're on.
Okay.
Well, I mean, slide 94, the one below it, not on the picture.
Okay.
So when it's specific heat of steam, is that a different specific heat? Okay.
Yes. If you remember when we were doing calorimetry, we were using water's specific heat all the time.
Mm-hmm.
That only pertains to it being a liquid in the liquid state.
Okay.
I don't.
So is there another?
There's another number. It's either for steam, it's either 2.09 or 2.06. I can't remember which one.
Okay.
And so it's going to be, you're going to multiply the mass by 2.09, say.
Right.
Let's go through a problem real quick. How much heat does it take to raise the temperature of 25 grams of water from 55°C to steam at 150? This would be a typical problem on a test. Okay, Ian?
Okay.
So I have got to, I'm going to write down some numbers here for a second. And I'm going to solve it on the whiteboard because believe it or not, it's going to be simpler for me to do it that way. Stop share.
Got it.
Okay, share screen, whiteboard. Okay, clear. All right. I've been asked to take it from 25 grams of water from 55°C to 150. Okay. So the portion of the curve I'm doing is this one, okay? Where it's water, so I know that the boiling point, what's the boiling point of water?
80.1.
No, come on, Ian. What's water boil at?
I don't know why I don't know this. Is it 100?
Yep. So I'm going from 55°C on the curve to 150°C. Okay. I need a couple more pieces of information. I know that my CS water, I'm sorry, My C liquid, my water is equal to, I know this is 4.184. Okay. I need my C of gas. Okay. I need my C of gas. And I also need, what other information do I need?
The amount of heat.
Nope. So the heat. That's what we're trying to solve. We're trying to solve the amount of heat to take water from 55 degrees centigrade to steam at 150. I need my delta H for my going from a liquid to a gas. All right. Okay. Let's just do it here. Can you? All right, so let me, I'm sorry I'm doing this to you again. So I'm taking it from here up to 100 degrees. Then I'm breaking all the intermolecular forces, making a liquid, turning it into a gas. Then I'm taking it up to 150 degrees. On the graph, that's what I'm doing. And so if you have to do this, Ian, just on a piece of scratch paper, do what I've just done here. So the information I need to give to you yet is I need to know what my specific heat of the gas is. And I also need to know what my heat of vaporization is. And I'll give you that information when I go back to the slideshow. Okay, Ian? So I'm solving three separate problems. Ian, you're back with me. Ian? Back with me, Ian.
Connected there, my apologies.
Nope, no problem. I'm solving three separate problems here, Ian. I'm solving.
Yeah.
I'm solving.
Okay.
The amount of energy it takes to get the water from 55 up to 100.
Right.
I'm solving the amount of energy that's needed to take it from a liquid to a gas.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm solving the third one, the amount of energy it takes the gas at 100 degrees to go to 150. Make sense?
Okay. Yes.
Then I'm going to add them all. Okay?
Okay.
But here is an important point. When I'm going this direction, if I'm going from a liquid to a gas, I'm going from a liquid to a gas, do I have to put energy to make something? If I'm going from a liquid to a gas, do I have to put energy into the system?
Yes.
So when I'm going, making a liquid into a gas, it is endothermic, right?
Right.
If it's endothermic, what is my sign?
Positive.
Positive. If I'm going in the other direction, that's going to be exothermic. If it's, and the sign of the exothermic is going to be a negative. Okay?
Okay.
So that's going to be easy enough for this equation. This is going to be easy enough for this equation because my delta T is going to be either negative or positive, right?
Right.
If I'm going in this direction, My T final is 100. My T initial is 55.
Right.
So 100 minus 55 is going to give me a positive number. Okay?
Okay.
So this equation is going to be the easy one. The hard one is the N delta H. And you have to think what's happening in the problem. If I'm going from a liquid to a gas, that's endothermic. So I have to realize what's happening. If it's endothermic, this equation is going to be positive. If it's exothermic, it's going to be negative.
All right.
Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
All right. So if I'm going from a liquid to a gas, this equation is going to be positive. If I'm going from a gas to a liquid, it's going to be negative.
Got it.
All right. So I'm going to get out of this and go back to the, no, I don't need
PowerPoint.
And I'm sorry I'm taking this long, but this is something.
Oh, you're all good.
This is something you're going to need. All right. So my problem, I'm taking 25 degrees of water from 55 to 150. I'm going to need to raise the temperature of the water from 55 to boiling point. Then I'm going to have to take the liquid to a gas. My third problem is I've got to take the temperature of the steam from 100 to 150. So I'm going to do three separate problems here. My first problem, my Q is equal to MC delta T. I've got 25 grams. I got 25 grams. I'm going to multiply that by 4.18 joules. Remember this, joules per gram Celsius, times 100 minus 45. I multiply this out, and I get 4,703 joules. Turn everything into kilojoules. Trust me on this. Turn everything into kilojoules, because when I do this equation, I'm using joules. When I use the heat of vaporization or heat of fusion, I'm using kilojoules. Just do it right away. Change everything into kilojoules. So okay. I've got my first problem. I have now taken my water up to the boiling point. Now I have to use my second equation because I'm taking it from a liquid to a gas. And the first thing I need to do is I have 25 grams. I need to divide that by 18 grams per mole. So I have 1.39 moles. I multiply my 1.39 moles by my heat of vaporization. This ends up with a positive 56.2 kilojoules. The reason it's positive, I have to put energy in to take it from a liquid to a gas. Last step, I'm taking it from 100 degrees as a gas up to 150 degrees. So I'm going to use the 25, the M specific heat times delta T. I'm going to use my 25 grams times my specific heat of steam times 150 final temperature minus initial temperature. I multiply this out. It gets to be 2512 joules. Turn that into kilojoules. This means 2.51 kilojoules. To get the total heat, I got to add the amounts from each step. I got to add the 4.05, the 56.2, and the 2.51. It took 62.8 kilojoules to go. Again, remember, you either have to turn this into kilojoules or you have to turn the kilojoules into joules in order to add them all up. Are we good, Ian? 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 Ian, we good? Okay. I'm going to go to chat room. Maybe you'll...
I'm back.
You're back. Okay. All right, Ian. Yeah, I can hear. Yes.
Yeah,
Ian.
My phone's being really laggy.
Okay. I'm not going to keep you much. I'm not going to keep you at all after this. Okay. Did you understand? Did you understand going through?
Sorry.
I get most of it. The only part I think that would confuse me on the problem would be figuring out which step I'm at, but that's really it.
I have another PowerPoint that I'm very sure if I haven't put it into the to my courses, I will right now.
Uh-huh.
But that other PowerPoint goes through more problems.
Okay.
All right.
Is the evening class still ahead too?
Yes. I'm going to start them. I'm going to start them at the same point I did you, Ian. So if you just want this, if you just want this portion of the lecture, I kind of started this at about, where am I at? Okay. I kind of started this at about a quarter after the hour.
Okay.
So if I do it the same, but they generally go a little faster than you guys do. They're just quicker on the responses back.
Right.
So, basically, if you want to join it at this particular point, I would say anywhere from 5 to 10 after 6.
Okay, I'll probably just join in at 5:30.
Good enough.
I just gotta remember. All right. Thank you.
Again, Ian, these problems aren't that difficult.
Right.
This last problem, the main thing you have to remember is that when you're using MS delta T,
right,
it's in joules. When you're doing N delta H, it's in kilojoules. You have to turn one to the other.
All right.
The other major problem I've seen is people not realizing that when you're going up the chart, that's endothermic. So when you're going from a solid to a liquid or a liquid to a gas, the sign of Q will be positive. If you're going the other direction, if you're going from a gas to a liquid or a liquid to a solid, that's going to be giving up energy. So that energy is going to be negative.
Okay.
All right.
Oh, another quick question. Is the lab final through Honor Lock?
Yes.
So can I use my lab notebook or no?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Because I just know it always pauses my screen, and I'm probably sure that it gives you a notification that I'm cheating or something.
I'm the final determinator of that, Ian.
Okay.
All right.
Because I got worried because it pauses on me every 5 minutes or so. So I try to do my best with that.
I apologize for it, Ian. I do apologize for that.
Oh, no big deal.
To be honest with you, I look for the thing I'm looking for, Ian, when I'm using Honor Lock, is that you're not accessing another browser.
Okay.
Or that there's not somebody behind you whispering the answers.
Okay.
So basically that's what I'm looking for. and that you're not on the phone.
Got it.
And I will make sure that I edit the things such that you're able to use notes, all right?
Okay, well, it's all good. I just want to ask ahead of time.
And you have until tomorrow at 5, I believe.
Okay.
And I will not get those graded until Thursday. And the reason for this is my car broke down on me over Thanksgiving, and it is now in Lighthouse Point.
Oh, geez.
So I got to go retrieve it.
Oh.
And it's supposed to be fixed tomorrow.
Oh, that must have been a fun Thanksgiving.
I've had better. Let me put it to you that way.
Well, I hope the rest of your day gets a little better there, Professor.
It's gone much better.
There you go. All right. I'll see you at 5:30.
See you at 5:30, Ian. Take care.